This is Joe Biden. Back in 2020, Biden sat down for an interview with CNN's Jake Tapper. Let's take a look.
Trump is reportedly considering a wave of preemptive pardons for his adult children and for Rudy Giuliani. He's also floated the idea in private conversations, according to our reporting, of possibly pardoning himself, which he insists he has the power to do, though that has never been litigated. Does this concern you? All these preemptive pardons?
And of course, CNN's reporting of this alleged wave of preemptive pardons by President Trump, which never came to pass, was fake news. I know you're shocked.
Look, our Justice Department is going to operate independently on those issues, that how to respond to any of that. I'm not going to be telling them what they have to do and don't have to do. I'm not going to be saying, go prosecute A, B, or C. I'm not going to be telling them. That's not the role. It's not my Justice Department. It's the people's Justice Department.
So Biden is saying that the Department of Justice will operate completely independent of the executive branch. And if you believe that, you'll believe anything. Because on October 15th, 2021, Biden stepped off of Marine One to answer a few questions from the press gaggle and said the following.
Defy congressional subpoenas on the January 6th committee.
I hope that the committee goes after them and holds them accountable.
Should they be prosecuted by the Justice Department?
I do, yes.
So instead of saying, I'll leave that to the Justice Department, Biden, who is very orange here for some reason, specifically said that he thinks that the DOJ should go after these people and prosecute them. So Peter Doocy of Fox News questioned White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki about Biden's change of heart.
Why did the president break his promise not to enter into any decisions about what cases the Justice Department should bring and not bring?
How did he break his promise?
This woman is full of it because she knows exactly how Biden broke his promise. Because less than 2 hours after Biden's comments to the press, she put out a tweet in an effort at damage control saying that Biden supports the independent role of the Department of Justice, blah, blah, blah.
You say that that is his view, but that is not what he said.
I just conveyed what his view is, and that is also how he has operated, how he has governed, and how he will continue to govern. And I think that's what's important for people to watch.
Well, we are watching it, and it's pretty clear that Biden's influence over the DOJ is very, very heavy. For example, during Biden's first press conference after entering office, he made multiple false claims about Georgia's proposed voting laws.
Deciding in some states that you cannot bring water to people standing in line, waiting to vote. Deciding that you're going to end voting at 5 o'clock when working people are just getting off work. Deciding that there will be no absentee ballots under the most rigid circumstances. This makes Jim Crow look like Jim Eagle.
So everything that Biden said there is demonstrably false. Every single thing. So false, in fact, that the Washington Post gave him the dreaded 4 Pinocchios rating for being a dirty liar.
Is there anything else you can do about it besides passing legislation?
The answer is yes, but I'm not going to lay out a strategy in front of the whole world and you now.
Spoiler alert, his strategy was to order his very independent People's Justice Department to do something about it.
Today, the Department of Justice is suing the state of Georgia. Our complaint alleges that recent changes to Georgia's election laws were enacted with the purpose of denying or abridging the right of black Georgians to vote on account of their race or color in violation of Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act.
And even though there isn't a single provision in the law that infringes on any Georgian's right to vote, it's not stopping Biden's DOJ from filing a frivolous lawsuit. For example, how is shortening of the deadline to request absentee ballots to 11 days before Election Day denying or abridging the right to vote on account of race? Well, it doesn't. Now, it sure seems like A.G. Garland is implying that black voters aren't capable of meeting a tight deadline, but you be the judge. Furthermore, Georgia voters have up to 11 weeks before an election to apply for a no-excuse absentee ballot, and that's nearly 3 months. And if the deadline is exactly the same for white voters as it is for black voters, that means it's not discriminatory. I cannot wait to see this go to court. Anyway, back to the White House press briefing, where Peter Ducey kept pressing Jen Psaki on the topic of Biden making demands on the DOJ.
So then what's changed since last year when he said, I will not do what this president, former President Trump does and use the Justice Department as my vehicle to insist that something happen?
Well, since you give me the opportunity here, former President Trump used his office to incite an insurrection. He put political pressure on senior DOJ officials to propagate lies about the election to the point where they threatened to resign en masse. I think there's hardly a comparison there.
So the question was, why is Biden going against his promises to the American people? And Psaki's answer was, because Trump. And that's fine. Because why be accountable for your actions when you can blame Orange Man Bad? Speaking of the Biden administration, you may have noticed that the United States is having a problem with inflation, supply chain issues, and unemployment combined with worker shortages. But don't worry, America, it's not a bug, it's a feature. Jason Furman, the former chair of the Council of Economic Advisers under President Obama, tweeted, "Most of the economic problems we're facing, inflation, supply chains, etc., are high-class problems. We wouldn't have had them if the unemployment rate was still 10%. We would instead have a much worse problem." I didn't realize that paying more for everything with money that's worth less than it was even a year ago was a high-class problem. But then again, maybe only the rich can afford $5 for a gallon of gasoline, I don't know. Of course, common sense would suggest that the high class are affected by rising prices the least, but who are we to argue with a Harvard economics professor? But then Joe Biden's chief of staff, Ron Klain, quote tweeted Furman saying this and using emoji to point to Furman's tweet. And considering that Ron Klain is Biden's right-hand man in the White House, his take is problematic. And so Jackie Heinrich from Fox News made an inquiry with Orange Woman Bad.
White House Chief of Staff Ron Klain retweeted a message yesterday, not once but twice, that inflation and supply chain issues are high class issues, but some of the sharpest price increases over the last month included products that every American buys, beef products, chicken, eggs, regular unleaded gasoline, laundry equipment, furniture, clothing, the list goes on. Why would Ron Klain tweet that, and would you agree that that's a little bit tone deaf?
Do you think two tweets means more? I'm just curious.
She is so freaking bad at her job. Of course, if someone tweets the same thing twice, it means more to them.
So just for context, what Ron Klain retweeted was a tweet.
You don't say.
From the former chairman of Economic Advisers, Jason Furman, where he said, for full context, which I think is important, most of the economic problems we're facing, inflation, supply chains, are high-class problems. What he went on to say is, we wouldn't have had them if unemployment rate was still 10%. We would instead have had a much worse problem.
And now, watch Jen Psaki squirm in her poor attempt at damage control.
So I think the point here is, well, there are some critics who are saying, what some of these critics are saying is, we don't know if they're saying that what they thought was great was when the unemployment rate was double what it is today.
I'm going to cut her off right there because she goes on for quite a while. Yet she never addresses the fact that Ron Klain, who is essentially running the country, endorsed the idea that high prices are high class problems. And I should also point out that this is the same Ron Klain that attacked the Trump administration over their economic policies, saying, will he hold up a Campbell's soup can and argue that the price increases for basic food items really don't hurt the middle class? Because I think that this is the Trump administration economic message of the day. So when Trump is president, high prices hurt the middle class. But when Brandon is president, prices are high because Build Back Better or something. Anyway, a few days later, Michael Shear from the New York Times asked a pretty substantive question about the Biden administration's response to the supply chain.
So just a question on the timing on the supply chain issue.
Yeah.
Actions that the president has taken. It was clear in March of 2020 when COVID hit that the supply chains across the world had been disrupted. Even as the sort of work to fight back against COVID proceeded, it was crystal clear that things were not improving on supply chain. People couldn't get dishwashers and furniture and treadmills delivered on time, not to mention all sorts of other things. So why is it
the tragedy of the treadmill that's delayed?
Right, the problem.
First of all, Michael Shear is speaking from personal experience because at the height of the pandemic, there was a waiting list to get Peloton products delivered, including the Peloton Tread. And while it's not a tragedy, he, like millions of Americans, weren't able to work out at the gym because of COVID restrictions. And being able to have a treadmill at home, that's a pretty good option to stay healthy. But instead of even having a shred of empathy, Jen Psaki would rather stand there and mock America.
The tragedy of the treadmill that's delayed.
But the serious point is, why didn't the president act sooner in a more aggressive way? I know there was a task force announced at some time earlier this summer, but essentially the president waited until, you know, now, right before the holiday season, to take these series of actions. Why didn't the president act sooner? And is that a reflection of the fact that his administration has failed to kind of anticipate and is much more reactive to these kinds of things rather than getting ahead of them as they should?
Well, that's not actually true. The president formed a task force at the very beginning of the administration.
Don't you see, guys? He was on top of it from the get-go. He formed a task force. And not only that, he signed an executive order on America's supply chains. I mean, sure, it didn't help, but they don't call him Empty Shelves Biden for nothing. Anyway, I think it's a good place to stop. Be sure to pick up your Let's Go Brandon merch from my store, and be sure that you're still subscribed to the channel. And as always, I hope to see you next time. If there is next time.